MedCram.
Thank you for joining me today. We're going to talk about medical acid-base disturbances in patients. And the purpose of this lecture is to make acid-base demystified to you. A lot of students come and are confused about acid-base. I've seen a lot of lectures on the internet about acid-base. Some get it right, some don't get it so right. I want to take acid-base as a whole and just start off from the basics and go through what you need to know and crack it down so that you can take a patient with an acid-base problem and not only figure out what the patient has, but also to be able to talk intelligently to other people about what that patient has and how you figured it out, and do it in a systematic way so you can understand. So let's demystify acid-base. So the first thing I want to talk about is some of the definitional things of acid-base. And that can sometimes be the most difficult. You know, the way you talk to people is a measure of how intelligent you are. And let's get some definitions down, because sometimes these are confused. So there's two things that you'll see a lot of in acid-base, and that is people talking about an acidosis. So acidosis versus acidemia. What's the difference between acidosis and acidemia? In fact, what's the difference between an osis and an emia in terms of anything? Alkalosis, alkalemia. And the way I like to think about that is in terms of a seesaw. Okay? You can imagine this big dichotomy in acid-base. You've got pH of 7.40, which is kind of where you want to keep things, right in the middle. And that's a neutral pH, and you can go all the way up to 7.45 and all the way down to 7.35. And what happens is you get processes that occur in the body. So let's say you've got a metabolic acidosis here, and you've got another metabolic acidosis occurring here. But over here you've got a respiratory alkalosis or another metabolic alkalosis. These are processes that can occur, and they're all occurring at the same time. And depending on the balance of these, because some of these could be big, some of these can be small, that's when you get your emia. So an emia is a state of being. You know, you have hyponatremia, hypokalemia. These are all situations that are occurring in the blood. So the key point here is that an emia is a state of being, and that's basically completely determined on what your pH is. If your pH is less than 7.35, then you're going to have an acidemia. If your pH is greater than 7.45, then you're going to have an alkalemia. Okay? So what is an osis? An osis is a process. It's something that's actually occurring. You can have many different processes occurring at the same time. So is it possible for you to have an acidosis but be alkalemic? Absolutely. You can have something down here which is trying to push your pH toward the acid side. But if you have something bigger up here that's pulling in the other direction and it's bigger, you'll still have a alkalemia because your pH is greater than 7.45, but you could have an acidosis. So again, basic line there is, when you're talking about the pH or something, make sure you use emia. When you're talking about a process that's occurring, think of a metabolic or respiratory acidosis. That's a process that's occurring. Okay, let's clear the screen here and sort of get back to some basics here. I want to start off with a little bit of equations that'll tell us kind of the basics for where we want to go. So what is the pH? Well, pH, as some of you all know, is equal to the negative log of the concentration of protons. So that's important, because as the number of protons in the body goes up, okay, the pH is going to go down. And so we know that a low pH means more acid. And then this in the body is sort of put together in kind of an equation where H, or water, plus carbon dioxide is equilibrated with carbonic acid, which is H2CO3, which equilibrates with a proton plus HCO3-. Okay, so why is this important? Well, because everything in the body sort of goes along with this equation. And I think the big key here is how the body deals with this player right here, protons. Okay, because protons is acid, as we just saw. And how does the body deal with that acid? Well, it deals with it using bicarbonate. Bicarbonate is the body's buffer that buffers against protons. So if extra protons are hanging around that could make the pH go down away from where it should be, of a pH of 7.40 or 7.35 to 7.45, which is that normal range, bicarb is used up. Now, bicarb can be used up either because the acidosis is the loss of that bicarbonate, or bicarbonate can be used up because it's having to buffer these protons and take these excess protons away. And so you can see what happens is the bicarb plus the proton goes to carbonic acid. Carbonic acid freely diffuses into water, which the body could always use, and carbon dioxide, which the body can breathe out. So if we put that into a new equation, and if you're lost here so far, don't worry. We're going to get to the final equation that I want you to sort of commit to memory, and that's this Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, which the body is governed by, which is the pH of the body is equal to 6.1 plus the log of the concentration of bicarb over the PCO2 times 0.03. Okay, now this looks like a daunting equation, but let's go over it. There are two factors here that you need to be very cognizant of. Number one is the bicarbonate. Okay, bicarbonate is a substance that is a base. Okay, so it's an antacid. It's primarily made in the kidney. And it takes a few days for that production to either go up or to go down. It could also be made anywhere acid is lost in the body through some metabolic process. And it can be used anywhere in the body to buffer acid at the same time. So anything that happens with bicarbonate, by definition, is a metabolic process. So if we have this bicarb going down, okay, then that would be a metabolic acidosis. If we have this bicarb going up, that is a metabolic alkalosis. That is a process that is occurring. It may translate into a pH, but we have to look at the other factor. The other factor here is PCO2. What is PCO2? PCO2 is the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the blood. Where does this carbon dioxide come from? Well, you know where this comes from. It comes from cellular respiration. Okay, so remember, glucose gets broken down into 2-3 carbon units, and those 2-3 carbon units get broken down to 2-2 carbon units, goes through Krebs cycle. Krebs cycle oxidizes that carbon down to carbon dioxide, and then it gets released, and that CO2 needs to be released. Carbon dioxide is a Lewis acid. So this is an acid, and this is produced in almost every single cell of the body, and it only has one way of getting out, and that is through the lungs. So if this is going up, that means the lungs are not getting rid of them. And that means this is accumulating in the body. And that would be if this is going up, therefore this would be a respiratory acidosis. So everything having to do with CO2 is respiratory. If this is going down, that means the lungs are getting rid of CO2 more. That would be hyperventilation, for instance. That would be a respiratory alkalosis. And so what we see here is a balance. We see bicarbonate, which is produced mainly in the kidney and can be lost anywhere in the body. So it's produced everywhere in the body and regulated through the kidney, whereas PCO2 is made everywhere in the body and is regulated through the lungs. If bicarb goes up, that's a metabolic alkalosis. If bicarb goes primarily down, that's a metabolic acidosis. If CO2 goes up, that's a respiratory acidosis. And if CO2 goes down, that's a respiratory alkalosis. Okay. Okay, so now since we've talked about bicarbon PCO2, let's go over some of the normal values for these things. So pH, as we said, is equal to 7.35 to 7.45. And that's the normal range. And what happens if things go out of this range? Well, the body doesn't work so well. Proteins start to denature, and that's why the body wants to keep things between that range, and we'll see how it does that. PCO2, okay, is equal to about 35 to 45. And you kind of remember that because there's similar numbers there. So we kind of like 7.40. PCO2, we kind of like 40. So 7.40 is kind of the normal, 40 is kind of in the middle. And finally, for the bicarb here, the range there is 22 to 26, with the normal being about 24, okay? So that is the middle of the range. Now, a couple of definitional issues. Sometimes you'll see bicarb also listed as CO2. Okay, you'll see that on what we call a chem 7 or something like that, or like a little graphic here that kind of looks like this. You'll see it like that, where you'll have the sodium, and we'll talk about this. You'll have the sodium up here, the potassium here, the chloride, and they'll say CO2 down here. Okay. That CO2 in that chem 7 is really the same as bicarbonate, okay? It's not the same as the PCO2. That's different. PCO2 is the partial pressure carbon dioxide. Here, this is the total dissolved CO2 synonymous with bicarb. So if you see CO2, it's the same as HCO3 minus. Just be aware that those are the same numbers, but that's different than the PCO2, which has a normal of about 40. Okay. The other thing that you'll see is a blood gas. Sometimes you'll see an ABG, and the form for that is you'll have the pH listed first, then you'll have the PCO2 second, and the PO2 third, and then you'll finally have the bicarbonate last. So a normal would be, for instance, 7.40/40 /90/24. That would be a normal blood gas. Okay, so we've gone over the normals. Again, this would be sodium up here, potassium here, chloride here, CO2 there. This would be something called the blood urea nitrogen. We'll get to that in a different lecture. This is creatinine, and that's glucose. If you've never seen this before, you might as well get used to it because it's kind of standard. And this completes the first lecture of the basics. We're going to go into a lot more detail here in the next ensuing lectures. Thank you very much.